So today let us discuss about classification of sensors, then what is meant by calibration, why you want to go for calibration and all. Then we will see about when you use a sensor, what type of output will be there from a sensor. All this you should know. Because once if you know what type of output that sensor will give, then only you can use it for your application. So these three topics we will see today. So let us start with the classification of sensors. So sensors is broadly classified into four types. The first one is based upon the power requirement. Second one is what type of output is going to give. And the third one is various types of measurements. Then comes principle of operation. Okay, so these are the four main ways by which you are going to classify the sensors. So first one, we let us start with the power requirement. So when you say power requirement is whether your sensor require any supply or your sensor doesn't require any supply. So based upon that, we call it as active and passive. You should know what is when you call a device as an active device, when you call a device as a passive device. So let us go back to your 12th. I think you might have an electronics paper there. One in last chapter of your physics, I think semiconductors. Okay, so why should you need a semiconductor? You have a person called conductor and you have a person called insulator. Conductor will allow current to flow, insulator will not allow the current to flow. Then why you need a person called semiconductor? The reason is I should have a flow of electron, but I should have a control over it. So whenever I want, I should behave like a conductor. Whenever I don't want, the same person should behave like an insulator. For that only you are going for a semiconductor. So semiconductor by birth, they are not conductors. You try to add some impurity to this particular fellow, and due to this impurity, that device is going to allow current to flow. Okay, in that case, see, you take resistor, capacitor, inductor, and diode. Okay, all these four fellows will have influence over flow of electron. See, depending upon resistance, what you say, see, you have polished surface, you have unpolished surface, you have mud surface, and you have clay surface. If you pour same amount of water on all these floors, the amount of water leaving that particular room will vary depending upon the surface. So that is nothing but depending upon resistance. So if the resistance is changing, then the electron flow will change, but this resistance is a fixed. If you buy 1 kilo ohm and put it in circuit, it will offer resistance for 1 kilo ohm. Greater than 1 kilo ohm, if current is going, then it will allow. Okay, so these type of devices is also influencing the flow of electron, but there is no external control. So all that you call it as passive device. Whereas when you say active device, after diode, so till diode, resistor, capacitor, inductor, and diode, you call it as passive. After diode, what they did, they used two diodes connected in anti-parallel, it became transistor. Then two transistor, they connected anti-parallel, it became SCR. They connected two SCR anti-parallel, it came your triac. Okay, so till this they were doing with current control. Whenever you will have a person called gate. So whenever this gate you give supply, then the device will get turned on. So our final goal is achieved. Your final goal is nothing but to control flow of electron. So similar way, here also there are some sensors which doesn't require any external supply for measuring. So when you use this sensor, you doesn't require any external supply. Okay, so let us start with passive first. So sensor that do not require power supply for measurement are called as passive sensors. So right side you can see a diagram where they have put a cross mark. See, a good engineer is nothing but you should have an ability to try to understand the symbol. Okay, so if the symbol is there, by no way you are not supposed to connect any electrical supply to that particular kit. So that is what they indicate. I think you all might have seen this voltmeter in your lab. So it is for measuring voltage. So measuring voltage is also a sensor to measure voltage. Where you doesn't give any supply to your voltmeter, okay, just you will connect it, the your needle will point the voltage which is flowing across your circuit. Okay, you are not supposed to say flowing across. Parallelly, you have to measure voltage. So across the two terminal, we will try to measure what is the voltage. So this is one of well good example for passive device. And next one is, we all know, which is thermometer. Olden days thermometer, you use only mercury as an person. So for change in temperature, there is change in pressure. Again, this you should remember. You might have studied something called Carnot engine, which says for any object, if there is temperature is changing, the pressure will change, or there will be change in volume. That is what happening in thermometer also. You have a bulb here, so based upon increase in temperature, this pressure inside will increase and try to increase your indication. So these two are the devices which doesn't require any supply, so that is why we call it as passive device. Next, let us move on to active device. So sensor that require power supply are called as active sensor. Same, you are going to measure voltage here. So when you measure voltage with help of multimeter, this requires a power supply. Okay, so based upon the power supply, this is going to measure. The power supply is only for the display and for the ICs which is being kept inside. Again, this type of symbol will be kept in a device where it requires power supply from external. Okay, so this was a present day, we doesn't go for voltmeter and all, we just connect multimeter and try to view it, because there are so many advantage of active device over passive device. Okay, then comes your this thermometer, and I think now all might have come across this thermometer due to pandemic situation. So this is fully digital, so again it requires supply. Okay, so the sensor for same application, you have both passive as well as active device, and again it depends upon the project which you are going to do. If your project is sufficient with passive device itself, there you should not go for active, and if it requires active device, at that condition you should not go for passive device, because somewhere where external disturbances, noises, environment, then it is advised to go for a special type of active device where you can try to minimize it. So first classification we have seen. So classification based upon power supply which you are giving. So either you have passive or active. Okay, next let us move on to another subdivision, is whether you are going to say output signal. So output from your signal can either be analog or digital. Okay, so there is both is required. You cannot say totally remove analog. There is some application where analog is more than sufficient. So I am giving all the example which you might have seen it. Okay, but when you see the textbook, they will give some other examples, but just for your understanding purpose, I am showing the same what you have seen in lab. Okay, and in some machines lab with the latest equipment, we will have these type of sensor, and all this sensor also will give only analog output. Okay, so analog sensor produce continuous signal that are proportional to the sensed parameter, where your output is in analog value, which means, see, for these all will give various output voltage. So when the sensing quantity increases, the output voltage will increase. So initially it will be in 0.61, then based upon sensing it will increase to 0.621, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4, and you are getting analog value outside. Okay, similarly here internally there is a spring arrangement, and there is some measuring circle inside which is going to measure your RPM. So again this is an analog type. Okay, next let us move on to digital. So digital sensor produce digital output that can be directly interfaced with the digital controllers, and nowadays even you can use for IoT, and you can transmit the data and receive it at a remote place. So all this is possible with respect to only digital sensors. So again this is a type of a tachometer, where it is a non-contact type. You don't want to keep it for any contact and all. Just a light source will be coming from this particular region. Either it can be laser light or infrared, whatever may be. both are available. So directly you will, this will fall on the measuring where you are going to measure speed, and it will be displayed. Okay, the only thing you should know that there is a difference between analog and digital is, digital is represented in forms of ones and zeros. So you can see after one what is the duration of zero. So based upon this ones and zero, I will identify what is the number it's or what is the value. Whereas in case of analog, it will be a continuous in nature. Depending upon the input, the amplitude will rise or amplitude will fall. Only thing you have to notice, when you say for analog, you have to talk about amplitude. But when you see digital, you are not supposed to say with respect to anything with respect to amplitude, because amplitude will be always, either it will be 1 or it will be 0. Okay, with respect to time, we have to speak. So be clear, whenever you talk analog, then you can talk about amplitude. Whereas whenever you talk with the digital, it is only ones and zeros. Between one single I, what is number of low, how many, for how much period it is in low. Okay, that is what with respect to digital. Then comes your temperature sensor. So next subdivision under type of measurement, you can see here. So here after analog digital, we have moved to third type of classification, where you called as various measurements. We call it as temperature sensor, pressure sensor, level sensor, then comes displacement sensor, then flow sensor and speed sensor. Okay, we will see one by one what are the sensors used and how you have to use it. Okay, so first comes your temperature sensor. A well-known temperature sensor is LM35. Some IC's number you have to buy at it. There is no other go, because the all that is mandatory required. Okay, when you move on to any industry, some IC numbers you should buy at and you have to tell. So one very popular fellow is LM35. This is for temperature. The air temperature is being measured by LM35. So you just, you place it in your room, then room temperature can be measured with this particular IC. Okay, so this is one of the most common and most popular sensor in temperature. Then there are some specification that this device gives output of 10 millivolt per degree. For so if it is 20 degree, then corresponding will be in terms of some millivolt. Then for 21 degree, 22 degree, there will be change in voltage, which is in order of millivolt. So amplification is required. So directly from sensor, you cannot go for direct displaying. In between, you will have some amplification circuit. Okay, so that is required when you want to observe it and transmit. I am not going to transmit and all. In that case, you doesn't want amplifier and all, you can directly use. Then Celsius rise in temperature. So temperature rise is with respect to Celsius. Then it consume 60 microamps. See, whatever you device you use, you should know what is its operating voltage and operating current. Okay, so when there is current flow in any particular device, obviously temperature will increase. You are using this person to measure the temperature, and if that person itself is generating heat, then your answer is totally wrong. What you have measured will be wrong. So that is why what they have done is, it consumes only 60 microamps current. So very, very low current. So due to this low current, self-heating of the device is as low as 0.1 degree. So less than 0.1 degree variation you cannot measure using LM35. That is the caution here. So less than this, if you want to try to measure, what will happen, it will obviously showing its own temperature, so you will let into a problem. But this value is very low. 0.1 Celsius is very low. The accuracy as high as 3/4 degree per Celsius, which means 1 degree multiplied by 3 and divided by 4. Till that level, I can go on measure my change in temperature. So there are, it is a 3-pin IC. Pin number 1 is input, we call it as input voltage. Then pin number 2 is output, where you are going to get the value for your measured temperature. And the third one is ground. So 2 will vary, starting from 10 millivolts, it will vary, the pin number 2. And the thing is, pin number 1 they have written is as 4 to 20, which means you can connect any supply range between 4 to 20 volts. So 5 volts, 10 volts, 15 volts, 20 volts. whatever you connect, this fellow will work, which is not mandatory that you can keep any value between the range of 4 to 20. Less than 4, it will not work. Greater than 20 also, this will not work. Okay, so that you have to take into account. So this is with respect to and LM35. Now what we are going to do is, you are taking LM35. So this is the circuit diagram for temperature detector circuit. This circuit, what we are going to do is, you are going to set it at a particular temperature. If the temperature is going beyond that particular, you are going to indicate with an help of lighting. Okay, I am using two LEDs. One is green LED, another one is red LED. When there is a glow of green LED, then there is no issue. Temperature is within the limit. When this red LED is going to glow, then automatically we have to understand that the temperature has increased the set value. Now, you should know what is set value. So, set value is being done with the help of this particular fellow, this resistance. Now, you see, you have come across 741, I think so. So, it is an operational amplifier. So 741 we are using just for amplifying and giving the output. Okay, now you can see here how the circuit is being drawn. You can visualize, I have given VCC here. So then I have even connected to ground here. You can visualize power supply is between 5 to 12. So this 5 to 12 volt will come across this particular resistor. Okay, across this resistor and then ground. And number 3 is negative, number 2 is positive. When you will have an output, this fellow is greater than this particular fellow, you will have an output. So under normal condition, when the temperature is less than set value, this value will be less, so there won't be any output. If there is no output, you can see here this terminal and this terminal is also ground potential, so obviously this LED will not glow. But if this value is greater than this particular value, when you are crossing your set value, what happens is your output will become 1. So if the output becomes 1, what happens is, now this potential with respect to this potential, this is higher potential with respect to this, automatically this particular red will glow. Once this red is glowing, you are shorting the path, so which means the terminal has been brought to 0. So this fellow will automatically move out, so only red light will indicate. So temperature sensors are used everywhere, like computers you use temperature sensor. I think you might all might have visualized, when you are using laptop or system, you might have seen a blue screen. That blue screen will come and thereafter you have to, only option is you have to restart or shut down. You have to wait for some time, again you have to start. That is nothing but thermal runaway problem in your processor. If you have might have continuously using your processor for any playing games which required more amount of memory utilization of processor, then processor will get eaten up. We have arrangement to cool the processor with the help of heat sinks and cooling fan, and there is a gel between your processor and the cooling fan. If that gel has become dry, then there is a chance for a small air gap between your processor and heat sink. So what happens is, now air gap is formed, so heat rather traveling by conduction, it has to travel only by radiation. Radiation temperature travel is not that much when compared to conduction, so your processor will get eaten up and it will show blue dump or it will show thermal runaway problem, kindly switch off and switch on. So if that message you are getting, then it has been nothing but the temperature sensor inside your processor has sensed that heat is not transferred from the processor to the external, so try to check your cooling system. So that is how it has been used in computers. Same case in case of mobile phone also, same you have processor and all such things. Then in automobiles, like air condition system you use inside your automobiles, where you use this. Okay, then in industry we have so many application, like boiler application, where water heating, water processing, where temperature has to be monitored. See, when you just, you say as you are boiling your water, see if it is going beyond a temperature, then there is a chance for blast. So there also you will use this temperature sensor. Okay, so next is pressure sensor. Pressure sensor is a device for pressure measurement of gas or liquid. See, when you are storing something inside your any container with the gas, again you have to measure the pressure of the gas. So you can do even some small project, like you might have seen biogas plant. Okay, what is biogas plant is, from cow dung waste as well as your house agriculture waste or any vegetable waste, you try to dump it and try to generate gas. In there, what you can do is you can put a pressure sensor, so you constantly you can measure your sensor. If it is reached your set value, then automatically you can turn off your LPG cylinder and turn on your biogas plant. So this can be done as a small project, like IoT based biogas plant. Okay, there you use this type of sensor called a pressure sensor. So see here, it is an IC with a tube. So this tube has to be kept inside the tank. So if the air at a pressure will try to flow inside this particular channel, and your ICs will measure. So pressure is an expression of force required to stop a fluid from expanding, and usually started in terms of force per unit area. So force per unit area you will try to measure. The pressure sensor usually act as a transducer. Initially what we started by saying, unit number one, there is a difference between actuator and a transducer. So actuator as well as sensor, common name is transducer. So wherever you use sensor, you can use a term called transducer also. Okay, pressure sensor can also be used to indirect measures. So this is a direct measure, is directly putting inside a particular chamber to measure the pressure of the gas. There is some indirect measurement also, that is nothing but you can measure gas flow, then speed. So based upon the wind place on your thing, you can identify what is the speed. Then water level also you can use in a closed container. If water level is increasing, the air region pressure will increase. So by reading the pressure of the air, you can say what is the amount of water is there inside that particular container. Okay, then pressure sensor can alternately be called as pressure transducer also. So if in your question they ask what is pressure sensor, it is same as what they ask for pressure transducer also. Then one more type of pressure sensor is available, where it is called as barometric pressure sensor, where you will have a hole. So it is like a capacitor. There is two plate, one plate you are giving pressure, another plate is fixed. So what happens if the force is exerted on the one plate, that plate will try to move. If distance between the two plates vary, then capacitance value will vary. So based upon the variation in capacitance value, I can tell about what is the pressure. So this is that type of sensor. So these two types of sensors are available for sensing the pressure. Okay, now application we have to see. Now you have to tell me what type of MOSFET is this. I think you might have studied, there are two types of MOSFET. One we call it as enhancement MOSFET, another one we call it as depletion MOSFET. Enhancement MOSFET, it will be normally off. By giving pulse, the device will get turned on. Okay, that you can understand by this circuit diagram. See here, there is no break between the line. This line, you don't have any break, which means under normal, when you are not giving any gate pulse, drain to source will be short. When you are giving pulse, this drain to source, there you will, based upon the voltage of the pulse, if you go on increase, from on it will come to off. So this is a type of MOSFET where you call it as, it is enhancement or depletion. It is depletion, initially on, finally off. So initially on, so if this pressure sensor is initially, it will not show high pressure. Piezo wafers we are keeping, it is same, it is like a capacitive pressure sensor. So I have told, no, second type of pressure sensor where you have a hole, you try to press the plate. If you press the plate, automatically it is like a piezoelectric effect, so it will generate. So whenever pressure is varying, this LED will glow and will try to bring it and try to turn off this. Once this is get turned off, what happens is this already you have kept short, now this short will get opened. So automatically 555 starts to generate pulse, and this pulse will try to operate your buzzer. So that is what, under what condition you want, that is been decided by this resistor and this capacitor. You have to properly choose. So for a particular level, when pressure is increased beyond particular value, this buzzer will starts to giving sound. So this is a circuit diagram for measuring your pressure. Okay, next let us move on to level sensor. Now there are so many types of level sensor we are going to see. A level sensor is a device that is designed to monitor and maintain the measure liquid. The one thing you should be very clear, all level measuring sensors are not same. They vary depending upon the application. For example, you have a Coca-Cola factory. If you go to Coca-Cola factory, there is you will bottle will move in conveyor belt, and from the top liquid will be poured. So amount of liquid to be poured has to be measured. So there you should have a level sensor. So you will have a tap. The tap will open, then it will fill a container. So that container you will place this level sensor. So it will identify and it will say okay. Then once that container is filled, then that container will be open and it will try to fill your bottle. So that is how will be done in case of bottling industry. Whereas in over a tank, same method we will not use. We will use different types. Okay. Once the liquid level is detected, the sensor convert the precious data into electrical signal. Level sensor are used primarily in manufacturing and automobile industry, but they can be used in household also. You can go for overhead tank, automatic turn on turn off of your overhead tank. So you can avoid overflowing of water and you can reduce your EB bill. Okay. And sometime what might happen is they will forget to switch off the pump. So it will be overflowing your overhead tank. Both water is waste as well as your EB power is waste. Rather, you can put an sensor like level sensor and try to measure, and you can directly switch off and switch on. Okay. Now, various types of level sensor. First is point level sensor, then continuous level sensor. In point level sensor, till a particular point you will allow it. Once that particular point is reached, then your sensor will give an output and you will try to switch off. Whereas in continuous level sensor, it will say you have 1000 liters, you have 25,000 liters, you have 30,000 liters. So it will continuously give the reading. First one will not give any reading like that. Okay. So if you have a big over tank for your corporation, there if you put level sensor, it is not sufficient by saying that water is there inside the tank. So what should you require? You should require the amount of water present inside the tank. Okay. So that is the difference. So in that case, what you have to use? You have to use continuous level sensor. So it will continuously, it will tell what is the current level of water inside the tank. Whereas in point level sensor, that method is not used. This can be used for your overhead tank. What we will do is, you will place the point level sensor at the top of your tank. When till it touch that particular value, your motor will be in on. Then once it touch that particular value, motor will be off. So you should have two point level, one at top and one at bottom. Again, if it is reaches the bottom value, you should turn on the motor. And again, this method is not used nowadays because we have gone for float method, where the float you can set cut point and set point. So when it is going below cut point, motor will start. When it reaches a particular value, it will stop. Okay. Then point level sensor are designed to indicate whether a liquid has reached a specific point in a container. So this can be used in your bottling industries. So Coca-Cola company, and the overhead drum, I told no, one drum will be there. That drum will get filled, then it will be transferred to bottle. In that drum I will have so many point level sensor. One point level sensor for 200 ml, one point sensor is for 500 ml, one point is for 1.5 liter. So at particular time, what we will do, we will only fill 200 ml, we will not go for 500. On next day, what you will do, you can go for 500 ml. So depending upon the day, depending upon, you have to choose the program, and that program will run for that particular point level alone. So that is for point level sensor. Then continuous level sensor on other hand are used to return precious liquid level measurement. The word precious liquid level, this is very important when you write continuous. So liquid level is not been mentioned by point level, only by continuous level. Okay. So level sensor can be divided further into invasive and non-contact sensor, which means one is, it will, whenever a liquid touches your sensor, it will give output. Another type is, there is no need to touch and all, without contact I can do. Why should I go this? Because this is purely depends upon the liquid. See, if I am using any acids, there the acid should not come and touch my sensor. In that case, I will go for non-contact type. The liquid which is not going to do anything to my sensor, then I will go for the first method. Okay, so that is two classification. Now I am showing here various types of level sensors. So first one is float switch. So this all you should might have seen. Even your western toilet will have this arrangement, that is float. It will be filling the tank. Once this float come and to touch this particular region, automatically water entering to the tank will stop. Okay, this is what we hold as continuous measurement. So I will have so many break points here, and it will tell about what is the level of water which is there. And this is optical, which is an example for point. So till this point it will allow. Once this touches this point, then it will stop. Again, this conductivity is also example for continuous, so you can continuously monitor. Then tuning fork, when this two is being touched by water, it will give indication. This is again similar to your single point. Then ultrasonic is non-contact type. All these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, first five are contact based, these two are non-contact. Okay, so one is ultrasonic, so I will send ultrasonic, that will get reflected back. So from sending and receiving, I will try to measure the time taken. From the time taken, I will tell what is the volume present. Okay, if there is more empty, then ultrasonic has to travel more distance and then come back. So distance can be calculated by time taken of your signal to get reflected back. Okay, so that is for ultrasonic. And ultrasonic you can use, even this is used in your ship. Okay, in ship, when you are in center of sea, I don't know what will be the depth of the sea, so I cannot put anchor and all. So before putting anchor, I should know what is the depth. Only by knowing the depth I can put the anchor. See, my anchor length will be around, say, maximum of, even I can have it for 200 meters or 300 meters length wire or cable, but I cannot have for kilometer and all. But sea depth is more than kilometer at some particular portion. So with the help of this ultrasonic method, I will try to identify the depth. Then I will try to put my anchor and try to stop my ship wherever I want. Then comes your radar type. This is single point you will send and receive. This will send in a huge surface, so your surface area is increased. So this will give a picture of a surrounding area. So this is usually used in aeroplane to identify any object which is closer to your aeroplane. Okay, so you will have a radar system, you will try to send the signal and get it back, and you try to plot it as, you know, surrounding of you, is there any other person. Okay, so these are the various types of level sensors available. Now let us move on to next one, is displacement sensor. Displacement sensor, what is the displacement of the particle is taking place? So displacement sensor is a device that measure the distance between the sensor and the object by detecting the amount of displacement through variety of element and converting into a distance. Okay, so best example where you going to see displacement sensor application is same bottling industry. Initially we were talking about the overhead tank which stores the liquid which is to be transferred. Now the bottle movement, whether the bottle has moved and stopped in a correct position, that you have to measure with the help of this displacement. Okay, this, so depending on what element used, there are several types of sensor, such as optical displacement, linear proximity sensor, and ultrasound. This linear proximity sensor is nothing but can be used only for metal. Optical is for any metal or non-metal. Then ultrasonic is for long distance. Okay, so these are the three main. So classification, you have optical displacement sensor, the linear proximity sensor. I repeat, optical is with the help of light source, linear proximity is with respect of for any metallic. Then ultrasonic displacement, then comes contact displacement and non-contact type. Contact here you have to touch and see. All these three are non-contact type. Okay, so let us see various. First one is using a light source, I told. So you will send this light will get reflected and there will be a receiving. So when at initial stage, the point where I receive the light is this particular point, and if the object has come closer to me, then the reflection angle will change. So initial angle, then this angle. So this angle, you can see that this is moved here. So now this distance I know, from that I will calculate what is the distance moved by this particular fellow. Okay, so again this can be used in application where, like this bottling industry. So from top I will send light source. When correctly bottle has came to that particular position, then it will show an I value. If there is no bottle, it will show low value. So I and low value, depending upon I and low value, I can say if it is I, bottle has come to the place where you have to pour, in that case this will be your result. So it will show that the bottle is closer to us. And if there is no bottle, then it will get zero here. So obviously object is now here. So when object is here, you will get reflected here. So this is how you will measure using a light. Okay, next comes your eddy current method, where this is field method. This is what we call it as proximity method. So this method, I am talking about proximity method. In proximity method, what I told is you cannot use it for bottling industry and all, because bottle and all is not metal. So there is something which is metallic portion which you are going to use. Okay, so what I am having is, I am having a coil. I will allow current to flow. Once the current flowing in a coil, magnetic field will be set up. This magnetic field will try to flow in both the direction, and then that will try to go and hit this particular metal. So there will be a flow of electron there, and this flow of electron will create a magnetic field, and this magnetic field will oppose this. This principle we call it as eddy current. Eddy current is whenever there is a metal region, metal near your field, then obviously that metal will allow the current to flow and try to produce magnetic field. So what I repeat, this is a coil where you give supply. When you give supply to coil, it will generate magnetic field. Magnetic field starts to travel. When it hits a metal there, the current will flow, and this current flow will try to produce a magnetic field, and this magnetic field will oppose this. This opposing magnetic field, once it comes here, it will have a change in with respect to my field. So change in field is red, and that with that I will be able to find what is the distance or what is the object which is there or not. Okay, and the last one is contact type. I told, in contact type the appearance will be like this. Okay, this metal will move in front or backward. So the object which you are going to see whether there is any displacement has to come in contact with this particular rod. So that is why we call it as contact type. So in contact type, where and all you can use this is any door, where door is opened or closed. So identify whether, see, you are in third floor, and if someone has kept your door open, then you should get some information that main door is open, ground floor main door is open. So there I will go for contact type. So that contact type, normally the door when it's closed, it will be here. When door is open, this will come out. Okay, so this is like LVDT principle. How I am identifying is, I am having two coil. If this core is in center, it will be zero. If the core is moving this side or this side, the coil which is coming in contact with this core will have more field. So difference in field will be shown as my voltage. So based upon the value, I will identify how the displacement is acting, whether displacement is in inward direction or displacement in outward direction. Okay, then comes your next type of sensor, which is nothing but flow sensor. So flow sensor is a water flow meter, is an instrument capable of measuring the amount of water passing through the pipe. See, in water flow, just whether water is flowing or not I can sense, or the amount of water which is going also I can sense. See, in European countries, both the inlet water and outlet water you have to pay. It is not like India. If you have water, you cannot use. Okay, so water which you get inside your home will also be recorded, and the water which is coming out of your house will also be recorded. Based upon that, you have to pay amount. If the coming out water is more, you have to pay more. So there they will use this flow sensors. So flow sensor will try to calculate the amount of water which is flowing. Okay, so there are four types of water flow meter. First one is mechanical flow meter, where you will have a disc. That disc will rotate based upon the water flow. Next one is vortex flow meter, then ultrasonic flow meter, and then magnetic flow meters. Let us see one by one. So this is mechanical. So you can see here, it is like a motor wheel arrangement. When water comes to this, this motor wheel will rotate. It is like a turbine method. So you might have seen generator and all, you say turbine. So when water is flowing here, this turbine will rotate. Based upon this turbine rotate, I will have a counter here. So how much fast it is rotating, then I will try to understand what is the water which is flowing. Okay, so it is like an indirect method where I am putting a sensor here and try to rotate this. This will have a teeth and slot. So teeth and slot, same example what we have seen here. See, you have teeth and slot. So same thing, which is now this is in linear fashion, that is in cylindrical fashion. Okay, so this is cylindrical in fashion. So when it is cylindrical, this, when water is flowing, this is going to rotate, then this is going to experience both teeth and slot. Based upon that, it will count number of teeth and slot, and it will identify what is the water flowing. So appearance of this will be like this. Okay, you will get an analog output. So based upon the water which is flowing here, you will get the analog value. From that I can measure what is the water which is flowing. Okay, then comes your speed sensor. When you see speed sensor, again this depends upon whether it is inductive in nature or not. So first type is inductive sensor being seen. So speed itself very clear, your bike speed, any person who is going to rotate, we should know what is its RPM, revolution per second. So for that, what you will do is you will put a disc to your rotor. In this case, you are putting a disc which is in magnetic in nature. So you say it as ferromagnetic rotor. So this magnetic type of material is being coupled with your person which is going to rotate. So now you can see here, I am having a coil here. Okay, that coil I am connected to permanent magnet. So when the current is flowing, it will generate magnetic field. See, magnetic field interference will be more when this is coming in contact with your teeth of your rotor, and when it comes to this region, it will be less. Again, it will increase, it will less. So I know I have how many teeth. Okay, I should know how many teeth are there. So if it is reading, if assume let us 10 teeth is there, and this will say 1010 for every teeth, it will say 1, non-teeth it will say 0 1 0 1 0. That is, when teeth is there, some amount of current will be flowing, that will be considered as 1. If teeth is not there, 0. So if counting is 10 times I have got, if there is 10 teeth and I am getting 10, then one revolution is over. So then what I will do is I will identify number of revolution, and then I will have a timer circuit and all. So how many revolution it is going for 1 minute, I will see. That is nothing but speed. Okay, so this is with the type of inductive nature. Then comes optical sensor. Optical sensor, what I am doing is same, this disc is going to be coupled with your person speed which you are going to measure. Now what is there is, there is a hole in your disc, but the procedure is same. There also you told in terms of teeth, here you are going to say in terms of hole. So this light from this will receive and it will be interrupted. When it is having hole, light will pass. When there is no hole, light will not pass. And I am this, I will have a counting like that. See, for example, 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 12. Okay, once 12 times if I received one, then I can come to know that one revolution is over. If you know the time for this 12, so divided, if you do, you will get your speed. So this is for speed measuring usable using optical sensor. Okay, next one is capacitive sensor. So now we are going into last subdivision. Last subdivision is nothing but in types. Already I think we have seen about resistive, we have seen in last class itself, last video. So remaining two is there, which is called capacitive and inductive. So now we have seen about temperature sensor, pressure sensor, level sensor, displacement sensor, flow and speed sensor we have seen. So then next two sensor which you are going to see is capacitive sensor and inductive sensor. This capacitive and inductive you have already seen here. Okay, but this is just a classification based upon principle of operation alone, that's all. But whereas this capacitive and inductive, we have seen already here where they might have used this same principle to measure, okay. So when we move on to capacitive type, there is nothing but you have one plate here, one more plate here. Distance between these two plates will tell about the capacitance effect. See, in between you have air, so air acts as a dielectric. When this plate is moving, then this area will reduce, so dielectric will reduce, then you will have a capacitance output here. Okay, from that I am going to use a trigger circuit and try to say value. So a capacitive center act like a simple capacitor. A metal plate in sensing phase of the sensor is electrically connected to internal oscillatory circuit, and the target to be sensed act as a second plate. So one plate is there and another plate is there. This plate is connected to an oscillatory circuit. So if this is coming near to this plate, then oscillation amplitude will increase. If it is going far away from there, the amplitude will come down. Okay, that is the way by which we are going to identify. Unlike inductor sensor, this process is an electromagnetic field. A capacitive sensor produces electrostatic field. When you go for inductive type, then it is electromagnetic. When you come for capacitive, it is electrostatic. Only that is difference, whereas both will have two plates. Both will have two plates. When you go for inductor also, you will have a plate. When you come for capacitor also, you will have a plate. So only difference between the capacitor and is, capacitor works on electrostatic field and inductor will work on electromagnetic field. So this is how your output will be. When it is far, this amplitude will be less. When the target is brought closer to your fixed plate, your amplitude will increase. So based upon the amplitude of oscillation, I will come to know that whether it is closer or farther. So that is the case for capacitive sensor. And then when you go for inductive sensor, so inductive sensors use current induced by magnetic field. That is what I have told. One is based upon electromagnetic effect, another one is electrostatic. So the inductive sensor use a coil. Whenever you say an inductive sensor, you have to come to this picture only. Okay, you will have a coil. Even clear picture if you want, this is the picture, this you have to draw. So when you are asked to draw about inductive, then you have to draw this. I repeat, you will have a coil. So for this coil you will give a current. This coil will, when there is a current flow inside a coil, that will generate magnetic field. That magnetic field will try to travel and try to reach this target object. So if it is a metal fellow, automatically this field will go and eat this metal and try to generate a current. That current will try to flow in that particular conductor. Due to flow of current, again a magnetic field, and this will influence this magnetic field. A person who is going to interfere for the cause which has created it, that we call it as eddy current. So based upon that only this inductive sensors is working. If there is a metal object near the charging magnetic field, the current flow in the object will be more. If it is farther end, then it will be less. And this type of sensor we call it as proximity sensor. So all type of metallic based sensing, we give a general term called proximity sensor. Okay, then we are move on to the next topic for today's section. We have seen classification of sensors. Next, let's move on to what is called as calibration. Calibration is nothing but, see, all the instrument will not be showing accurate value, even though if they are manufactured from same company, same brand, same slot, because there is so many other reasons like manufacturing, there will be some type of calibration has to be required. So calibration is nothing but, instrument calibration is one of the primary process used to maintain instrument accuracy. So repeatedly we will do this, we will try to adjust the component inside so that you try to get the correct value. So calibration is a process of configuring an instrument. So that is what I have told. So it is like a configuration. So buy a sensor, bring the sensor, check the sensor with the standard sensor. Standard sensor will show the accurate value, and this sensor which you have bought will have some error. If there is any mechanical structure in sensor, then you will vary that and try to vary the output. If there is no mechanical, then you will know what is the error. You will multiply that error and get your value. So that is how calibration will be done. Elimination or minimizing factor that cause inadequate measurement is a fundamental aspect of instrumentation design. See, in real world, if you are placing a sensor, then I should get accurate value, and if that is not showing accurate value, that may lead to endanger. So proper calibration at regular interval of time is required. So that is what they say, eliminating or minimizing factor. I cannot, in all the case, I cannot eliminate. Okay, I can only minimize. So minimization will try to increase the accuracy of that particular measurement. So this is called as calibration. Then no sensor is perfect. Okay, simply to sample manufacture variation means that even two sensor from the same manufacturing product run may yield slightly difference in reading. The difference in sensor design means two different sensor may respond differently in similar condition. Okay, if put it in the same room, one will say it is 21 degree, another one will say 20 degree, and if this is placed inside your bedroom, then that is not going to affect more. See, if your AC is showing whether 18 or 19 or 20, you doesn't bother. You bother only whether you are in chill or not. Okay, whereas this is not the case in factory. In a factory, in a room, when you want to measure, if it is beyond a set value, then there is a chance for some failure of the device which is being used. For a best example is Google server. If you have come across a video for Google server, if not, today you go and try to see. Just to put the Google server diagram or Google server video, if you see Google server as a processor and an hard disk. See, all over world simultaneously there were so many people will try to operate with Google. See, even now we are having our class with the Google Meet, which means with all the things what we are, your ID, your photo, my ID, my photo and my presentation, everything goes to Google and then come back. So Google server will store all this thing. Then think about the processor temperature there. So processor temperature will be very high. So you have to go for cooling method. They go for ice cooling and all. So that ice cooling there, if I reading a slightly different value, then that will affect more. So that is what we mean to say. That is why we say you should go for calibration. You cannot directly buy a sensor and you cannot believe the sensor value. Just whatever sensor is saying, you cannot take that is accurate or which is correct. Okay, first you have to check it with standard one. So whenever you buy a sensor and try to do a project, what you will do is take that particular sensor, bring it, then keep it with respect to standard, try to give the same value for the both fellow and see what is the difference. From there you will calculate the error and then you will do your work. Sensor subject to heat, cold, shock, humidity, etc. during the operation may yield to their accuracy level. See, if you are putting a sensor for 10 years, then what is the reading shown at the time of purchase will not be there after 10 years. So after 10 years, it will show some error. That error is due to heat or even cold or even choke or humidity of that particular environment. During storage, shipment and assembly may show a change in response. Okay, so this is what we call why you should go for calibration. Some sensor technologies age is nothing but that what I told. If you are same sensor is used for more than 10 years, then it will show error value. So frequently what you have to do is you have to take that sensor and check it with standard one and try to identify the error. Then you have to multiply that error and all, and you have to get the actual value. So what affects precision? Usually a precision of any sensor is affected by 2%. One is called noise, another one is called hysteresis. Hysteresis, I think you all know. We also have hysteresis property. Hysteresis property is when you are repeatedly asked to do some work, then we will get saturated. Once we get saturated, we will not do. Even if the pulse is giving from the brain, do the work, we will not do, which means we have gone to saturation. So similarly, all your device will go to saturation. When you are operating based upon capacitive effect or inductive effect, this both fellow will have a person of hysteresis. So residual capacitance and residual inductance will take place inside your device itself, that may leads to error. Okay, noise is nothing but your surrounding. IEEE standard says your room should have a microwave of 150 milliwatts. Microwave, what I am saying, I think you should know clear, that is your telephone signal. We all use cell phone. This cell phone requires power in your room. So the service provider are sending the signal, and that signal is coming to your room, and that signal value, I think it will be in order of, IEEE says it is 150, but India we use 1500 milliwatts. See where is 50 watts, sorry, where is 150 milliwatts and where is 1500 milliwatts. 1500 milliwatts is nothing but 1.5 watts. So you are sitting inside a room where continuously you are getting 1.5 watts on your skin. So that may leads to so many issues. Okay, so that is called noise. So noise will try to go and affect your sensor and try to show error. So these are the two which is going to bring your precision down. So based upon that, you have to make arrangement in calibration. Okay, then last topic in unit number 1, which is nothing but sensor output types. So output of the sensor, what and all is possible. One is analog voltage value will be there as an output from the sensor, or PWM. PWM is nothing but pulse width modulation. So number of pulse per duration, we call it as PWM. For if you say for 50 milliseconds, what is total number of pulse, then it is called as PWM. You call it as 80% modulation, 90% modulation, or 100% modulation. And the last one is serial data. Nowadays you are not using analog type or PWM type, we are using serial type, because serial you have an advantage that can be traveled for long distance. So plant might be in somewhere, and somewhere you can sit and take the reading. See, for example, I think you all know where is LIC in Chennai. So LIC is in Mount Road. So backside of LIC you have a something called a Tangent Co. TN Power, Tamil Nadu State Power Transmission and Distribution, that is called, we call it as Tangent Co. That office is there. So I think even you will go for IV there. There you have a SCADA system. So in SCADA system, I will sit and monitor the entire Tamil Nadu, where and all power is being generated, how this power is being transmitted, how this power is being consumed, everything. In that case, the only possible way to send the data from the generation station, from distribution station, from consumer to the control room is serial digital data transfer. So that is now popular. Serial itself is, you know, either it is 1 or 0, send in a sequence. So you will send either 1 or 0 consequently over a single wire system. And again, see, for serial communication, only 2 wire is more than sufficient. Whereas when you go for parallel and all, you would require more. In case of analog voltage, the problem is you have to go for amplification and all. So that is difference, and we are going for serial. So now let us start with analog value. Analog value, you will have a particular volt, say V minimum is 1 volt and V maximum is 4 volt. So your output will vary between 1 to 4. So at an instant, it may be 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5, 4. So based upon this, you are mean to say that your output from the sensor is varying. Okay, so some sensor output and analog voltage proportional to some parameter which they are sensing. Below shows a typical analog transfer characteristics. See, minimum voltage, maximum voltage. Okay, sensor, when it is not receiving any input, it will show 1. Then based upon the input, the output will vary and it finally reaches 4. The slope of the curve is usable region is usually specified in the data sheet. So when you buy a sensor, and if you say that sensor is going to give analog value, then they will write within bracket what is the range, 1 to 4. If they write output voltage is equal to 1 to 4, which means your output of the sensor will vary between 1 volt to 4 volt. Okay, then the most common technique for noise reduction. Here, noise reduction, is you have to go for differential signal transmission. I think in upcoming semester you will see there is, I think even you have in microprocessor, I think it will not come in embedded system and all, it will come. There is a something called differential signal transmission. So in that way you have to transmit, then only you can come out of the type of noise reduction and all. Okay. Since we are using microcontroller, it may be convenient to apply IIR or FIR filters. Again, this DSP paper you will read about what various types of filter, and there you see fast Fourier transform filters. That filter will try to remove the noise from your signal. Okay. Next is PWM. This is what I told. So based upon the sensing, the T on and T off will vary. So this is total time. When the output is increasing, then T on will increase. If the input is reducing, then T on will reduce. So based upon the sense, so it can maximum, this can be the T on with the zero T off, and minimum signal is zero T on with the maximum T off. If the sensor is reading minimum value, then T on will be less. If the sensor is reading maximum value, then T on will be maximum. That is the case for your PWM based method. Okay. And this is serial digital. Okay. In serial digital signal are most complicated, where you can see either you will have 1 or 0. This means that there is 2-1, which means here there is no 1. So with this you call it as data signal 1 0 1 0 1 0. We will have, and we will try to send it to your channel. So only two wires is required. One is for a channel, another one is for clock, and or we will call it as clock plus signal. That is for your serial data transfer. I think with this your unit number 1 is over. Now let us discuss something apart from this, so that